Good morning. Good morning. God bless you. Thank you for coming out this morning. It's the spiritual market day of the week where we come in here and we fill up on good news. Key word, good. And everybody knows what's going on. Everybody's been watching the blues. And we see the world we live in and the condition that it's in. And there's one remedy. And you're sitting in the right place to hear about it. So our moment to ponder this morning is from Isaiah. And that verse says, with this news, what news? Good news. And you're going to hear that today in the chapter that we're in. We've been in John for a year, but we're coming down to the nitty-gritty of John where that tomb in Israel is empty. That's good news. Because that's where the victory is. So it says here in Isaiah 35:3, with this news, strengthen those who have tired hands and encourage those who have weak knees. Just want that to lie there for a minute. If you think you have strong hands to deal with this, you're wrong. The battle belongs to the Lord. Because the arm of flesh will always fail you. People, places, and things will fail. But Jesus never fails. And he's the answer for whatever ails you, whatever you've got here this morning. So if you're tired, be encouraged. I love people that encourage me. You encourage me, I'll follow you anywhere. I want to be encouraged. This world is not in the business of encouraging you. It has nothing to encourage you with. It's like the old Hollywood movie set. You go behind the outward wall and there's sticks propping it up. That's how they made the old shows on TV back there, Studio City in Hollywood. It's all phony fronts. And our society is steeped in that right now. The only thing that'll work is God. And remember, he's the same yesterday, today, and for how long?
Forever.
So let's stand and open our service with his worship this morning. Make this our worship prayer. I love singing our prayer on Sunday mornings. We have a great way of just inviting the Lord to take his rightful place in our service.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Jesus Christ from whom all blessings flow. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Jesus Christ from whom all blessings flow. Let's open up.
Lord, we praise you for who you are this morning. Thank you for being on the throne. We ask you to bless our time together, our fellowship. Oh, Lord, we love our koinonia here at Lacey Christian Assembly, this little country church on the edge of town. May your Holy
Spirit. Light us up today, because it's in you we live, breathe, and have our very being. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen.
Let's open up our hearts. Let the living waters give our lives to God. Let's open up our hearts. Let the living waters give our lives to God. Praise the Lord. Christ from whom all blessings flow. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise to Jesus Christ from whom all blessings flow.
And so is God. Hallelujah. Man, that lit me up. I like it. It's like a strong cup of coffee.
Amen.
That's what worship does to you. It lights you up.
Good morning. Good morning. How is everyone today? Do you love the sound of that tambourine?
Yes.
Yeah, welcome. We're so happy that you're on a good foot and you're back to church. Millie, we missed you. And we have a visitor today, Austin. Paul brought Austin, so thank you for coming. It's great to have you here. Announcements, Knitted Hearts is going to be this Tuesday at 10 o'clock. And Sister Linda's going to be here to play her harp. So we're going to enjoy that today. We always love when she comes for worship. Bring your lunch. We're in the third part of the second chapter in the book that we're doing on Psalm 27. That starts at 10. Bring your lunch because we like to hang out together afterwards. Wednesdays in the Word, we started the book of Ruth, and we'll continue that this Wednesday. That's 1 o'clock. No children today. Holy Grounds will be after church. So, Fred, you moved, and you totally, like, short-circuited my computer. I was looking for you right there. I'm sorry. So coffee and bagels after church. But welcome back from your vacation. Welcome back, Moose and Elsie. And Fred, we waited, of course, because it's birthday Sunday and we can't do it without you.
It's time for your tithes and offerings. Bring them down, because this is the church that you sow into. You come here, you get fed, and it all goes into the hopper for the Lord, because he uses it to take care of the temple and to do outreach and supply everything that we need. Because you can't outgive God. I've tried it, and you can't do it. So give him everything that he deserves, man. All your time, energy, and resources. You can't go wrong with that. Let's pray for the offering. Lord, thank you for this offering that belongs to you, Jesus. I pray that you bless everyone that gives from their heart, Lord, that you would pour out a blessing so big they couldn't contain it, as your promise says. And you told us to test you in this and see if we wouldn't pour out a blessing so big. I know I've tried it, and I pray that for the people here, Lord, that you do a work in their heart and their life. We'll be sure to give you all the praise and the glory and use it effectively for your kingdom, in Jesus' name.
Thank you. He who was before there was light walked across the pages of time. He who made every living thing, behold him. He who heard humanity's cry left his throne to wake as a child. He became like the least of us. Behold him. Jesus, Son of God, Messiah, the Lamb, the roaring lion. Oh, be still and behold him.
He who died with sinners and saints, healed the blind, the lost, and the lame. Even now he is in our midst. Behold him. He who shows a criminal's end, paid with blood to settle our debt. Very death as he rose to life. Behold.
Kingdoms, above all thrones, above all. Above all power, above all things, above all nature and all created things, above all wisdom and all the ways of man, you were here before the world began. Above all
love. Jesus, your King.
There's power in the blood. Power in the blood.
Would you lift daily His praises to sing?
Wash away my sin. Wash away my sin. Nothing but the blood. There's power in the name of Jesus. And that power is right here, available to each and every one of us right now. Take all your hope, all your confusion and fear. Bring it to the Lord. Sing His name this morning.
Jesus, your name is mine. Jesus, your name will break every stronghold. Jesus, your name.
Do you believe that here this morning? Sing it for all its
worth. Jesus, your name is power.
Is power.
Oh, yes. Jesus, your name.
We came here for you, Lord. We love you. Touch us now this morning, Father God. Meet every need here. He came to heal the brokenhearted. A lot of brokenhearted people in our world right now. Where do you run to? Run to him right now.
His name is Jesus. Jesus, sad hearts need no more. He has healed the broken hearted, opened wide the prison's doors. He is able to deliver evermore. His name is
Lord, we come together as a family that loves you this morning. Be glorified and magnified in our midst, Lord. We thank you that we can come together to worship you. We ask for miracles to take place right now. Spirit's here right now. What do you need here this morning? I came to him out of a prison. I was locked up tight with heroin addiction, everything, and he came in and set me free totally and healed me. Now the power of his Holy Spirit can do that for you. Just ask him to baptize you afresh right now, because this world is coming to where it's coming to. You see where it's coming to. Only God can help you right now. So look for him everywhere. Holy Spirit, make this your prayer.
Fall afresh on me.
Fill me with your power.
Fill me with your power.
Satisfy.
Satisfy my need.
What do I need from you, Lord? Everything.
Only you can make. Give me strength to make me grow. Come, Holy Spirit, fall afresh on me.
Lord, we ask you to bless this service in a special way. We look at the condition of our world right now. We're hungry, we're thirsty, we're tired. Lord, we want to hear from you today. Give us everything that we need. You can do 1,000 years in one day. Imagine what we can do right now if we bring it to him. Give him everything you have.
Only you can make me whole. Give me strength to make me grow. Come, Holy Spirit.
Lord, we love you.
of the living God.
Bring it to him this morning. Man, we had all kinds of situations going on this last week. I don't know how many calls I got for people that were in trouble. And the only thing we can do is bring it to him in prayer. Prayer is our weapon. It's our 911. And God is here right now, ready to deliver for you. So what do you need to bring to him this morning? Maybe it's fear of the future. We look at our world right now, it's shaken to its core. And God said these days would come. And in his book, remember, it's all coming together. It's not coming apart. So if that's confusing to you, stick around today and hear the word of God. Let him give you a roadmap for where we're going. But right now, you can bring all your needs to him. So in James chapter 5, it says, is anyone among you suffering? In verse 13, let him pray. Anyone cheerful, let him sing psalms. We just did that. There's nothing like singing to the Lord. Songs in the night. You ever have a song in the night? When you're tossing and turning? God will give you. Say, Lord, give me a song. And then you crack open the book of Psalms. And you look at, you just break it open in the middle of the night. And you can start right there. I just cracked open Psalm 66. Make a joyful shout to God, all the earth. Sing out the honor of his name. Make his praise glorious. Say to God, how awesome are your works. Through your greatness of your power, your enemies shall submit themselves to you. All the earth shall worship you and sing praises to you. They shall sing praises to your name. That was a Bible roulette thing. I just cracked it open and bam. In the middle of the night when you've got all that sleep eye in your eyes, you can't even see straight. God will give you a song in the night. So it says, verse 14, anyone among you, and this is in the book of James, chapter 5, anyone among you sick, let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And the prayer of faith will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he's committed sins, he will be forgiven. There you go, that big word, forgiven. What are you carrying today? It's too heavy for you to carry. He carried it to the cross for you. He nailed it. And we're going to see that today, the victory that we have in him. Verse 16, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. So you come right now. Let me pray for you.
He has shown me.
shown thee, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of thee. We keep saying it over and over. And to love mercy. Why does God do that? There's something about repeating it over and over again. Those simple choruses were came out of the Jesus Revolution, where God reached down and touched that whole generation of wild hippies on the West Coast, all tripping on LSD, no shoes, bell bottoms, love, peace, happiness. And they didn't really, they were on the right street, but the wrong house. You could be on the right street, but you haven't reached the house, and you're looking for it. You're going, where is my life? What do I do with my life? It's all screwed up. But and then God repeats it. They started singing songs like that. They made these simple choruses up. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice over and over. There's something about repeating it. Scripture memories like that. As you repeat it, it gets into your heart and your spirit. And then when you're in a situation, bam, it pops up. And all of you say, where did that come from? So what does God require of us? And right now, boy, there's a lot of anger in our country right now, a lot of dissatisfied people ready to scream and fight. But remember, like the old saint told me years ago, the arm of flesh will always fail you, but Jesus will never let you down. So we're continuing in our journey in the Gospel of John. And boy, I love this book. And now we're coming down to the clubhouse turn, so to speak, as they say in the racing business. We're continuing our study in John. We remember that John himself told us the reason that he wrote the whole book. And what's that reason? Let's read it. These are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. John chapter 20, we're in 20 today. John chapter 20, verse 31. That's the life. The life you've been looking for. You might not know it, but that's where it is. And the Bible doesn't lie. So as we continue each week, my prayer is that we'll experience the richness and fullness that Jesus Christ offers to anyone who believes. 2 weeks ago, we ended our study in chapter 19. Jesus had given up his life, and he was buried in a tomb belonging to Joseph of Arimathea. Here's a picture of the tomb. We can't imagine the despair and brokenheartedness that his disciples were going through at that very dark moment. Think about that. The despair and brokenheartedness. We got a little glimpse of that yesterday on the news. Despair and brokenheartedness. They had stood by while their teacher, master, and the one they believed was their Messiah, was tortured, crucified, and died. They had dedicated 3 years of their lives to following him. They were following him, they were learning from him, and they were embracing his message. And they were sure that he was the one. And now their hopes were squashed, their dreams were shattered, and their hearts were broken. Nothing like a broken heart. We've all been there. But this was heavy. Even though Jesus told them many times that he would rise again, they forgot his promise. In Mark chapter 9, Jesus told them, "The Son of Man is being betrayed into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And after he is killed, he will rise the third day." The disciples couldn't believe or wrap their minds around what he meant by rising on the third day. What are we talking about, biscuits here? Rising? How does one rise? When you're dead, you're dead. I mean, get a glimpse of this. This is hard to swallow. And they knew that their beloved master was dead. There's such a finality there. In this chapter, we'll see the disciples' hope and faith rekindled, and their joy return in abundance beyond their wildest dreams. Their Savior was alive, and he was true to his promise. Take him there, folks. He's given you a promise. Take that. In fact, I ain't even going to tell you to take it to the bank because the bank won't be there. It's bellying up. But his promise, he'll never fail you. Can you relate to these disciples? Is your hope squashed? Are your dreams shattered? Is your heart broken? We can learn a valuable lesson. Take notes here today. Pay attention. This is good stuff. You can't buy this stuff anywhere you go. It only comes from the Word of God and from his heart. So we can learn a valuable lesson from this portion of Scripture today, a very important chapter. Things are not always as they appear. Or as it says on the screen, things aren't falling apart. They're falling into place. I love that. God is working his plan, a plan for our good. Let's read this together on the screen. And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God and to those who are called according to his purpose. Romans 8:28. This is our promise. Our risen Savior has the answer to all that concerns us. And he's working his plan for our good. Remember that. Don't give up and don't give in to fear and discouragement. Here's another great promise. Let's read it. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord will personally go ahead of you. He will be with you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. Deuteronomy 31:8. That's the New Living Translation. What a promise. That covers you. I mean, bumper to bumper warranty. Only God can give you that. Even in times like this. Let's get started with our study today. Hold up your Bible. Say your word is truth. It's the whole truth and nothing but the truth. Please open your Bible to John chapter 20. We'll begin in verse 1. Page 1674 in that hardcover church Bible. We put it there for your reading enjoyment. Remember, you can't tell the players without a scorecard. Have your nose stuck in that Bible day and night. Don't go by what they're telling you on the blues, because nobody knows. They're all confused. That nobody knows the answer. Look at verse 1 in chapter 20. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb early while it was still dark and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. Unquote. We're talking about a stone, a couple of tons. You don't stick that in your pocket and walk away. So let's pray. Lord, thank you for this miracle of you, that you came for the broken and the lost. Tore up from the floor up, beat up from the seat up, all of us, Lord. Whether we're up and out or down and out, we can come to you with all of our hurts, pains. And Lord, we pray that this chapter would come alive right now in the name of Jesus to each heart that hears it as we look at your living word. Your Rhema word, it's alive, it's powerful. Speak to our hearts this morning and give us exactly what we need, because we look to you. We know nothing else is going to work. It's only you, in Jesus' name. And everybody said? So Jesus, and listen to this, Jesus entered the world very quietly, born in a manger, and he exited the world the same way. The resurrection was not a spectacular event with crashing cymbals and blaring trumpets and 4th of July fireworks. The discovery that Jesus was alive was like the quiet dawning of a new day defeating the darkness of night. Just a few hours ago, if you look east out here, maybe you were standing down on the shoreline. This is what you would have saw coming up over the Atlantic Ocean. The dawn. Just the crack of dawn. When that little bit of light comes out, the risen Christ revealed himself to his disciples personally and intimately. Do you have that kind of relationship with God? Do you? Personally. Intimately. That's why at the crack of dawn is the best time to sit and talk to him.
And he walks with me and he talks with me. Why did they write that song? The author of that song spent time with God. And before the day gets going, that's the best time because it's quiet. Not even the birds are up. And then you hear the rooster crow. Why does the rooster crow at the same time every day? Do you ever wonder about that? God has a timetable and a time clock. The tides come in at a certain time. The sun comes up at a certain time, goes down the same. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the name of the Lord shall be praised. It tells us that in Psalms. So the risen Christ revealed himself to his disciples personally and intimately. God desires that you have that relationship with him. And if you don't have it, ask him today. Say, Lord, take me into the deep water. And sometimes he'll turn your life inside out, upside down. He gave me a life sentence in prison. But you know what it did? It woke me up. It said, I'm done. I'm done with this life. I want what you have, God. Show me. And he began to do that the day I asked. He didn't kick the door in. He waited for me to say, help me, Jesus. And he knew I meant it in my heart. So these disciples, man, they were going through a real crisis situation here. At unexpected times and places, they were overcoming their grief and doubt. And Jesus revealed himself to his disciples personally and intimately at unexpected times and places, overcoming their grief and doubt, just like he met us, personally and intimately, overcoming our grief and doubt. Take that. And tuck that in your quiver today. He'll help you overcome your grief and your doubt. The Gospel of Mark, verse 16, 1 tells us that the other women were with Mary at the tomb on the first day of the week. And the reason they went to the tomb was to further anoint the body of Jesus with spices. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus had already anointed his body on the day he died. But I think the women wanted to do that. They wanted to honor Jesus their way and do the same. So they decided to go to the tomb on the first day of the week, the day after the Sabbath. The women were probably wondering how they were going to roll away that stone and get to Jesus' body. But they didn't let that stop them. They went expecting to find a very heavy stone and a corpse. But to their surprise, what did they find? The stone was rolled away, and there was no corpse. It was this, empty. As I studied this verse, it brought to mind how many times do we face situations in life experiencing closed doors and dead ends. And then, bam, surprise, surprise, the Lord opens the door and breathes life into our impossible situations. Can anyone relate? Well, let me refresh your memory. Read this with me on the screen. But Jesus looked at them and said to them, with men, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. With the emphasis on all. God can do anything. He created the universe. He parted the Red Sea. He turned water into wine. He raised Jesus from the dead, just to name a few. Psalm 138:8 tells us that the Lord will perfect that which concerns us. Perfect. You've been praying for a long time. Don't give up. It gets weary. It gets hard. You're wondering if that person will ever change. Don't give up. You never know. You never know when that time comes. I've seen it happen time in and time again, where people were written off, gone, they'll never change. And then all of a sudden, bam! It was like they got hit by lightning. What happened to that guy? He can unscramble scrambled eggs. Look at that sign. What does it say? You can't unscramble a scrambled egg. You ever try to do that? But God can. He did it to me. Man, I was about as scrambled as you could get.
Trust them, LCA family. No situation is too hard for them. Look at verse 2 in chapter 20. Then she ran and came to Simon Peter and to the other disciple whom Jesus loved and said to them, "They have taken away the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him," unquote. Mary, in her natural mind, was trying to explain a supernatural event. Grave robbing was common at that time, so much so that the Emperor Claudius placed a capital sentence on the crime. All tomb raiders were to be put to death. Mary must have been shocked when the stone was already rolled away and they did not find the body of Jesus. So she automatically thought someone stole it. And then she ran to share the news with Peter and John. I love how John frequently refers to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. John was so secure and settled in the fact that Jesus loved him that he was confident and comfortable referring to himself in that way, the one whom Jesus loved. We should all be secure, settled, and confident and comfortable in the love which God has for us. And we should all refer to ourselves, say me. We should all refer to ourselves as the same way John did. I am the one whom Jesus loves. Say that with me. I am the one whom Jesus loves. Yes, you are, and so am I. Look at verse 3. Peter therefore went out, and the other disciple, and were going to the tomb. So they both ran together, and the other disciple outran Peter and came to the tomb first, unquote. The Gospel of Luke tells us that the women went to where the 11 and the crew were staying. Sounds like to me the disciples were all in the same place. When they heard the news, most of them didn't believe what the woman had told them. It was just not believable. So the crew accused the women of spreading idle tales. We have to admit, what the women were saying was pretty incredible news, that the tomb was empty and the body of Jesus was missing. Unlike the others, Peter and John heard the news and immediately started for the tomb. There they go. In keeping with John's humility, he doesn't refer to himself directly, but only as the other disciple. John was humble enough to avoid the mention of his own name. But for some reason, he thought that it was important for us to know that he outran Peter to the tomb. There we go. Feet don't fail me now. Peter might have been the older, bigger. He might have been older and bigger than John. Or maybe Peter was not in good shape like John. So Peter just petered out. Whatever the case, we know that they both ran hard. Peter and John had just heard life-changing news that the tomb was empty. Their love for Jesus prevented them from being indifferent or detached to this news. They had to see for themselves. I love that song my friend Bob wrote, "Come and see, come and see." We have to come when we come to that place, come and see that Jesus is alive. Here's a little piece of information. The phrase "petered out" goes back to 1810 when miners were looking for gold. When the vein of gold ran dry, the miners would say that it petered out, meaning it dwindled, diminished, or faded away. It became used up or exhausted. It is thought that the phrase originated from Peter's denial of Jesus because his faith had dwindled. I'm so glad that Peter did not stay in that state of dwindling, having his faith fade away. Peter is remembered for being a bold leader in the early church. He was crucified upside down because he felt unworthy to die in the same manner as his master, Jesus Christ, whom he deeply loved and revered. One thing that we always talk about here at LCA is, there it is, finishing well. And you're all coming to the finish line. It's coming up. Don't dwindle. Don't fade. Don't blow it. Don't get off the path. You know, the straight and narrow path. It's so easy to go either way. And it can happen in so many different ways. That's why as you're fixed and focused on the Word of God, it'll keep you. It'll sustain you. It'll keep you fresh and serving. Always go after the lost and the broken, because we're one step away from being there ourselves. It can happen in a flash, like we saw yesterday. It can happen in a split second. Life can change. You can be in the middle of a sentence, and life can change just like that. God lets us see things so we know what's going on and who's in charge. So finish well. Peter had a few bumps in the road, but he made it across the finish line with excellence. Let's purpose to do the same, church. If you've fallen, get up. Get back in the race. Time is getting very short, and the finish line is in sight. Look at verse 5 in chapter 20. And he, stooping down, looking in, saw the linen clothes lying there, yet he did not go in. Verse 6. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb and saw the linen clothes lying there. Verse 7. And the handkerchief that had been around his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but folded together in a place by itself. Unquote. The typical rich man's tomb at that time would be large enough to walk into, with a place to lay out the body on one side and a bench for the mourners on the other side. The entrance might be an opening 3 feet high and 2.5 feet wide. It was large enough to get into, yet there took a bit of bowing and turning, and you had to wiggle your way in and out. For some reason, John did not go into the tomb. But when Peter came, he went right in, and John followed. This was very characteristic of Peter. He was action-oriented, impulsive, and courageous. John was more reserved and tended to think about things. How chaotic life would be if we were all impulsive and action-oriented like Peter. And how boring life would be if we were all reserved and slow to act like John. God created us all with different characteristics and personalities. Amen on your behalf. So that we could complement each other, capitalizing on each other's strengths and weaknesses. We see that here in our body, right here at the LCA. We all have different strengths and abilities. That's why we need each other. Amen. We are better together. You believe that? Yeah. Don't isolate. Don't isolate, because that's where the enemy comes in and makes you start stinking thinking. Oh, poor me. Nobody understands me. Hey, I was the best one at that. Self-pity. That thing will immobilize you and rip you off of your life. When you serve the Lord, you ain't got time to feel sorry for yourself. I complained that I had no shoes and I saw the man with no feet. And what did it do for me? Gave me an attitude of gratitude. It's so important. We are better together. Peter and John saw the linen clothes lying there, but Jesus was nowhere to be seen. A mixture of ointments, aloes, and spices applied to the linens would dry and harden them. The normal removal of these burial wrappings would require tearing and cutting. Peter and John saw that there was no removal of the burial wrappings. They weren't like scattered all over. And they were beyond befuddled about what they were seeing. It's kind of like this. Say what? Somebody folded them. Here's a quote from the Scottish theologian William Barclay. The grave clothes did not look as if they had been put off or taken off. They were lying there in their regular folds as if the body of Jesus had simply evaporated out of them. Unquote. Put yourself in Peter and John's shoes. What would you be thinking? Look at verse 8 in chapter 20. Then the other disciple who came to the tomb first went in also, and he saw and believed. Seeing is believing. Verse 9, for as of yet they did not know the scripture that he must have rise again from the dead. Verse 10, then the disciples went away again to their own homes, unquote. The Greek word for saw in this verse is eidon. It means to see with comprehension or understanding, to perceive the significance of. The empty tomb and the folded grave clothes made it very clear to John that Jesus had risen from the dead, just as he said he would, and that he was alive. Man, there's so many Christian songs written about that. He's alive, he's alive. As of yet, John and Peter and the women did not understand the whole dynamic of the resurrection and all that went with it. John believed that Jesus had risen from the dead, but he did not have a clue as to why it had to happen. As soon as it became clear to him, but for now, John knew in his heart that what Jesus had told them came true. He came to know the resurrection through what he saw at the tomb. Only later did they see it in Scripture. I look at my own life. I was a walking dead man. I'm alive now. And I can feel. When you do drugs and alcohol, you can't feel. It kills your feelings. That's why you get that hard shell. Because it's not you. Jesus restores every bit of that. Or you can get that from a relationship. It doesn't have to be a substance. You can get bitter and hard because you got burnt. My daddy hit me in the head with a 2x4 when I was a little kid and locked me in the closet. I hate him. I hate his guts. But then when you come to the Lord, all of a sudden that it's like he pulls a plug out of you and all that hate goes out. Because that's the worst thing you can do is hate somebody. Because it'll eat you alive. That resentment and that bitterness that you carry will eat you alive. God can heal that. That's what this is all about. So it's so beautiful. Only later did they see all this in Scripture. They went to their own homes and most likely to tell everyone what they had seen. Look at verse 11. But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping, and she wept. As she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb. Mary did not go back with Peter and John. She stayed at the tomb. As of yet, Mary didn't have the revelation that Jesus was resurrected, so she wept. She wept at the tomb. She was grieving and trying to understand exactly what had happened to her beloved rabbi. Look at verse 12 in chapter 20. And she saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. Verse 13, then they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Unquote. These two angels sitting where the bloody body of Jesus had lain are a reminder of the two angels that sat on the mercy seat in the temple. Look at the comparison. The mercy seat in the Old Testament was a place where the blood of the sacrifice was sprinkled, the atoning place, and angels were on either side of it. This Old Testament comparison is a powerful foretelling of Jesus being the atonement for our sins. Last Wednesday, as we started the book of Ruth, we used a quote about Augustine. And Augustine said about the connection between the Old and New Testament, which fits so perfectly here. Augustine said, "The new is in the old contained, and the old is in the new explained." You see that so clearly here, beloved. God is so cool when you read the Bible from cover to cover. You understand that it's a whole love letter to you. Say me. You. Let me ask us a question. What would be our response if we saw two angels? We might be fascinated, intrigued, overwhelmed, but not Mary. Two angels in white speaking to her, and she could care less about them. She had one thing on her mind. Jesus, her Lord. She's looking for Jesus. And here's the point. When our hearts are longing for Jesus, nothing or no one else will do. There is no substitute for Jesus. All Mary wanted was her Lord. Look at verse 14 in chapter 20. Now when she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know it was Jesus. Verse 15. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" She, supposing him to be the gardener, said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me, where have you taken him, and I will take him away." Verse 16, Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him, "Rabboni," which is to say, teacher, unquote. Just one word. To me, verse 16 is one of the most tender, sweetest verses in the entire Bible. In the middle of Mary's grief, confusion, doubt, and heartbreak, the sound of her master, her teacher, speaking her name changed everything. He loves you that much. And I hope you love him that much. I think of that song Sandy Patty sang years ago. No, it was Larnell Harris and Sandy Patty. I've just seen Jesus. And it builds to a crescendo at the end of the song that raises the hair on your neck. But it's that powerful when you see him and he loves you and you're a part of him and he's a part of you. What a lesson we can learn. Jesus had only to say one word and all was explained. All he said was Mary. One word changed her sorrow to joy. Do you hear him calling your name right now? She went from despair to hope. Jesus met Mary where she was and revealed himself to her. How often I wondered, where is God? Where is Jesus? Life's getting hard. We get ourselves all worked up in a tizzy, become discouraged, and all the time, Jesus is right in front of us calling our name. He said, "I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. I am with you to the end of the age." He's always with us, but sometimes in our trials, in our sorrows, we don't see him. Let me encourage you today, LCA family, to look for him. He was there all the time, waiting patiently in line. I had him at the end of the line. Even after I ran away from God, after knowing him, he was still there. But he was at the end of the line. Finally, I saw it. And when I did, I ran back to him. And he kissed me and held me and welcomed me back like the prodigal son. My friend Billy Batstone wrote a song, a chorus, with the word of God. And it's called, "He's Calling Out Your Name." And I want every one of us here in this room right now to listen to this song. In fact, we'll have the words up here. Let's sing it together. And remember that he's calling out your name right now, and then we're going to pray. The most important thing is that you hear him.
He's the Lord of every season.
He's the master of all time.
Humankind, the eternal word of heaven is among us in this place, and if you have ears to listen, you can hear him call your name.
He's calling out your name. He's calling out.
He's calling out your name. He's the Father of all mercy, and your silent prayer has been heard. He will satisfy the thirsty by the water of His word. The bread of life is broken, Jesus is proclaimed. May your eyes be open to the one who calls your
I can hear you call my name. Amen. So what did we learn today? Number one, don't give up and don't give in to fear and discouragement. Two, God can unscramble scrambled eggs.
But you don't understand. Nobody can fix it. I'm in a mess. Nobody understands me. That's what I used to say. Then I went to a place and everybody was jacked up like me. And they had a sign on the wall that said, "You're not alone." And I heard somebody share this story, and I went, "He's telling my story. How did he know that about me?" But he wasn't. He was telling his story. You're just as messed up as the guy down the street that claims he's got it all together. You understand what I'm saying? You're not alone. We're all in this together. Koinonia. And number three, finish well. It can happen in a split second. 1 minute you're speaking, the next minute you get shot. It can happen in a split second. You pull out of the driveway and a dump truck comes by. Gone! Happened on 539 on Wednesday, me going home. I had a detour. My friend who's a chaplain with the other police department called me and said, "Lady crossed the lines, ran into a semi. Expired on 539. It can happen in a split second. Finish well. And how do you do that? Make sure your heart is right with God. I'm going to give you an opportunity here in a minute. Number four, we're better together. No man is an island unto himself. That was years ago. I don't even know where that's from, some playbook or something. But we're meant to be together. Koinonia, fellowship. What we're doing here right now, this is what God loves. Fellowship, there's a lot of empty seats. We pray that God fills them, especially during these turbulent times. This place should be banging right now. Pray for that in your community. Pray for your neighbors. We're better together. And five, there's no substitute for Jesus. A lot of people try to substitute it. The world is loaded with cults. Don't expect what you don't inspect. Know this book so you don't get ripped off. A lot of fakes out here. You got to know the real thing, and the only God will show you how to do that. Stay in his word, right? There's no substitutes. And six, yes, he is. He's calling your name. He's calling it right now. So every head bowed, every eye closed, let me pray with you. Lord, thank you for the close of the service. Thank you, Father God, for your word today. We think of Mary, and she was looking so hard for Jesus. And all she wanted was Jesus. And then she saw him, and he called her name. One little word shall fell him. Thank you. A mighty fortress is our God. Lord, thank you, Father. If somebody needs to do that right now, I pray that they would hear you calling their name and say, I surrender, Lord. Oh, that's all you got to do is give up and surrender. But mean it in your heart. If you're ready to do that, whether you're watching on our YouTube channel or you're here right now, all you have to do is say this prayer and mean it in your heart and then pick up your cross and follow him. Oh, what a time to do that in. When everybody's looking for that Savior, we know that you died on the cross and shed every drop of blood. If you're ready for that and invite him into your heart, say, Dear Father, I come to you now in Jesus' name. And I ask you, Father, forgive me of my sins. I invite your Son, Jesus Christ, into my heart as my Lord and as my Savior. With my mouth, I confess Jesus Christ. And in my heart, I believe that you raised them from the dead. Now, according to your word, I'm born again. I'm saved. All my sin has been forgiven me. I'm yours and you're mine. Help me, Father, to live a life for you from this moment on in Jesus' name. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Anybody say that for the first time? Slip up your hand. If you're home and you said it, slip up your hand. God sees it. And then get in touch with us so we can hook you up with resources, how you can dig in and study the Word of God. There's so many rich resources that will help you grow in your faith. And remember, the faith comes by hearing the Word of God. Anybody recommit their life today? Slip up your hand. Amen. Praise God. Amen. You can lower your hand. Let me pray for you. Lord, I thank you for everyone here and everyone at home that might be watching this. We get a lot of reports of people that get touched by your Holy Spirit simply watching on YouTube. Lord, I pray that if they're nearby, they would come visit us. And if they're far away, they would reach out to me so I could plug them into a Bible-teaching church that'll give them the Word of God straight up with no chaser. We thank you, Father God, for your love and your mercy that you provide everything we need. I pray that you would bless people now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost in Jesus' name. Let's close with one of our favorite songs, and then we'll have some fellowship downstairs. Remember, church, he's faithful and true. Even when the times look scary like they do, pray for that spiritual revival in our country. We're doing 30 days of prayer and fasting right now, so if you want to join us, just join in and offer it up to the Lord and pray for our nation.
You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true, so faithful to love us. You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true.
Sing it again.
You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true, faithful to love us. You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true. And when there comes a time I falter and I call upon your name, and I know that you are
Lord, bless everybody today. Give them a good day as they head out. Keep them safe as they pull out of the driveway. Look both ways. That's a high-speed road. Make sure you look both ways before you enter the highway. Lord, give them a good week. Bring them back Wednesday for our midweek fill-up in the book of Ruth.
We'll be sure to give you all the praise and glory.
When there comes a time I falter, Lord, and Lord, I call upon your name, and I know that you are faithful to remove my guilt and shame.
Oh, you, Lord, are faithful. Faithful and true, so faithful to love us. You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true.
Hallelujah.
Yes, you, Lord, are faithful. Thank you, Jesus. Faithful and true, faithful to love us. You, Lord, are faithful, faithful and true.
We love you, Lord.
Faithful and true.
Every day.
Faithful. Remember to walk with the King and be a blessing. Lacey Christian Assembly, where the little country church on the edge of town. We just come to praise the Lord.